What does it take to stop the churn of dependency and homelessness permanently? This is the Leaders of Transformation podcast, and on this show, we interview difference makers and world changers who are disrupting for good. I'm your host, Nicole Jansen, and our guest today is Chris Megason. He is a social entrepreneur, the co-founder and CEO of Solutions for Change. And since 1993, Chris has designed and led numerous free market social purpose initiatives and innovations that have solved homelessness permanently for over 4,500 people. I actually got an opportunity to tour their facility here in their headquarters, actually in Vista, California recently, and got to meet some of the people on their team and even those that are going through the program. And it was so inspiring that I was like, I have to reach out and see if I can get Chris on this show. And so I'm really excited to have him here. Chris, welcome to the Leaders of Transformation.
Thanks, Nicole. It's great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
My pleasure. So Solutions for Change, where did the idea come from?
Well, it was after the first Gulf War. So for people that have they've been around for a while, you know, that was a long time ago. I had lost a, out of all things, I lost a push-up bet, and the loser that weekend had to go serve in a soup kitchen line. And I would usually win these bets, but as fate would have it, and of course, later I figured out it's all divine and it's all navigated, so therefore it's divinely navigated. I'm serving this bowl of soup on a Saturday, and I had a lot of, as a man of faith and someone who's really concerned and had a history myself, growing up in some tough environments and surviving some tough things, I'd always had this empathy and compassion and concern. But so I'm serving a bowl of soup, and the volunteer next to me, gives me the elbow, and he says, "Man, watch out, there comes Wolfman." And I look up, and there's this guy with hair all over his face. I mean, you could barely see his blue eyes. And I'm ladling this bowl of soup, and I say, "Hey, man, what's your name?" And he just growls at me, takes his bowl of soup, and he goes and he sits down in the corner. Nobody would sit next to him. But I said, "You know, like, I'm not afraid of Wolfman. I'm going to go." I ladle myself a bowl of soup. It was right at the end of the line. I go over there and sit down. Longest 20 minutes, you know, there's just kind of slurping, both of us, you know, eating our soup, and no real talk. And finally he says, "You know, my name's Steve." And over the next like 40 minutes, he described his life. And it was so moving to me. I was asking questions and listening. And later, you know, after we became friends, he told me that the only reason why he shared all that with me is because when he was younger, he wanted to be a Marine, and he lost his mother and his father in a tragic situation when he was young at 18, jumped into a bottle of whiskey. And, you know, I'm sitting there with him, you know, some, you know, 30 years later, listening to, you know, to his story. And so I couldn't get this out of my head. You know, I went back to the base, you know, and it was just, it's like, I got to see what this guy is talking about. And so I had a 40, we had what we called a 96. It was actually, 96 hours, you know, 4 straight days. And so I packed my rucksack and I went out there to see what Steve was talking about. And what I learned and what I saw changed the course of my life. And I'd like to share a little bit about that. But, you know, the short of it is I went back to the base and I couldn't get the stuff, what I saw, out of my head. And I was up for reenlistment. I was a very happy and accomplished Marine. I had done a lot of you know, things that I felt really proud of, and I liked the Marine Corps. It helped me, I think, find my way in a lot of ways, and become a man and learn how to serve for the sake of others. You know, it's not about me; it's about serving others. And I walked up to the Marine enlistment officer and I said, "You know what? I'm going to get out and I'm going to go work for this faith-based organization that was helping the homeless." And I started doing that in 1993 and have been doing it ever since.
Wow. Wow. I mean, that's a huge decision. And especially when you've invested so much into your career, when you mentioned about the time that you spent, did you actually go, you actually slept on the streets, you spent a certain amount of time. Is that what you did?
Yeah, I wanted to see exactly. So I just put a beanie on my head and I, old green jacket on. And what here's what I saw. I saw a lot of churches and well-meaning nonprofit organizations out there, and it was a flurry of transactions. You know, it's just there were soup bowls and shelter beds and you know, blankets and sleeping bags flying all over the place. It's like a, you know, I liken it to like almost like a battlefield of compassion. But those compassion, they were transactions largely. I didn't see a lot of connection. I saw a lot of people stuck in this thing. Of course, later, as you mentioned, we called that thing the churn. And it was just a lot of people wanting to serve and help, but people really not getting out of this thing. In fact, I saw a massive level of enabling and, you know, what I know to be codependency from my own life, growing up with an alcoholic father, and a very codependent mother. And so the whole system seemed codependent. It was like, you know, yeah, I love you, but, you know, there's really not any real, like real compassion, in my opinion, is like, I got to get to know the person. I want to know who they are, what's going on, what got the person homeless. And so anyway, I saw all this. I saw people cash their, get their GR welfare checks for, you know, $170, walk across the street to the liquor store, cash it, and have a bag of crack cocaine in their hand all within 15 minutes of getting their check. I didn't see that once or twice. It was an entire system, hundreds of people getting their, you know, government checks, cashing it across the street, and a whole system of some really dark stuff. It was very dark and very sad. And so, you know, a lot of people suffering in addiction, a lot of addiction. So when I went back, you know, I just said, man, there's got to be something better. And of course, having grown up with a father who was amazing, very accomplished man, I later learned was a high functioning alcoholic. And there's a lot of dysfunctional stuff in my family. I learned that I was the oldest of five, and my brothers, three of them, got the addiction gene. I got the codependency gene. And so when I figured out that I too was attracted to addicts and alcoholics, it's interesting because, of course, my work today, but I had to learn how to take care of myself. And that was a very, very long and challenging process of looking in the mirror and having had, you know, I was doing that in the 80s in the Marine Corps, going to Al-Anon meetings, you know, in the evening. I remember walking into Apple Street in Oceanside, the Al-Anon meeting, and a bunch of black belt women, Al-Anons who were amazing. They learned how to be healthy and have boundaries. I walk in and I'm in a relationship with an alcoholic woman, and they just say, shut up, take the cotton out of your ears, put it in your mouth, and listen to what we have to say. And I learned from them how to, you know, this problem of addiction that we have in our country, and it's out of control now. It's just everywhere, right? It you can only get there through, in my opinion, through systemic codependency. So we have this government that says we care, we're compassionate, but they have operationalized a system of codependency. And I can see it, and others like me see it, because we live through it on a personal level. It's the same exact thing, watching your father or someone you love die from a condition that is deadly and has one goal, which is to kill the person. And you're watching that, and then you're seeing, you know, your mother, or you're seeing other people in your family enable it, even promote it at sometimes, and there's all kinds of dysfunctional, you know, reactions to it. That is exactly what is going on in our society today on a massive multi-billion-dollar containment level system that the, you know, state of California calls the homelessness response system, but it is largely dysfunctional, very toxic. Of course, we see it, and a lot of the people that now today I have the benefit of surrounding myself with incredible overcomers, people that have been there on the streets, have, you know, been near death, not just one or two of them, but dozens and dozens of them who have grown up out of that, now work with me, have, you know, incredible responsibilities, and help others do the same thing that they were shown, the same way that they're shown. So, you know, it all started with that, you know, with that few days looking at it on the streets and being impacted by it. Then, of course, that was, you know, I worked for that organization. It's a very large organization in San Diego that still exists. And then in 1999, I'm running the winter shelter with my wife, and I got my two boys there helping me out. They're, you know, volunteering. And this beautiful nine-year-old girl walks up to me and she says, "Hey, mister, do you live here too?" And I'm like, oh man, this nine-year-old girl is homeless, living in my shelter designed for homeless men. And I look around and there's quite a few homeless families starting to come into that shelter. And I get down on one knee and I say, "You know, sweetheart, I don't live in this place, but I'm going to make you a promise. We're going to get you out of here and get you back into a home." She tears up. I'd be lying to you if I told you this old Marine didn't tear up. And in that second, Jessica, that nine-year-old girl, launched a movement called Solutions for Change. My wife and I left that nonprofit and we started Solutions for Change really on a wing and a prayer, with really nothing. But we knew we had to do something about the families, and the place that we were at was really focused on the homeless men. And so that's how Solutions for Change started almost 24 years ago.
Wow. And there's so much in there to unpack. I wanted to touch on something that you shared prior to us actually doing this. You were in conversation, starting the conversation recording, is you mentioned about the three things that are differentiated. And I heard that in what you were talking about, the problem, you talk about the codependency and the systemic, that churn, and, you know, how you were talking about with me about the unique differentiator. And that's what I saw. When I saw there, I saw hope and I saw transformation. I saw a solution that wasn't just for, and there's a reason why obviously you called it Solutions for Change. You know, it was a solution that was a permanent solution. It was, hey, you know what, we're going to help you to get out of this situation, and we're going to help you so that you never, ever go back there, that generations forward don't ever need to go back and get caught into that churn. And so the education, that whole academy and all the things that you do is just, you know, amazing, because it is literally, I'm very passionate about transforming the way people see themselves, others, and the world around them. And I do believe that's biblical, right? And so it's like this transformation that's happening, that's permanent at a very core level. So talk about those, you know, those kind of the three things that you're really known for, and then we can unpack it in specifics.
Yeah. Thanks for asking, you know, about that, because I think, you know, a lot of times people think, you know, here's a nonprofit that's helping the homeless. And so they immediately kind of get an idea, or they think they know. And I understand, right? And the one thing I really understand being in this now for over three decades is that my constituents, the people in our public, they're really upset about this whole thing. I've never seen them so frustrated, concerned. I'm talking about our public, right? So, you know, we're a nonprofit 501c organization. We exist to serve our public, and I see the public as our customers. So they have needs, you know, and as the homeless folks that we serve, the families we serve have needs. I see them both as equal customers, as equal constituents. Now, obviously, you know, we exist to solve family homelessness. And the first thing I think that, you know, sets these three uniques up is that see and solve the root of the problem versus the symptoms of the problem. And that's our first unique, and what we I love this. It's the three uniques. It's not ours. We got it from the Entrepreneurial Operating System. It was created by Gino Wickman. Less than 2% of all nonprofits use this operating system. I love it. It's helping us break through that ceiling, if you will. Any entrepreneur can identify with this stuff. But, you know, what are the three things that really make your company, your organization, your nonprofit, whomever, different? And some might have one and some might have two, but no one has three. And so these are the three things that we believe that really make Solutions for Change different. And when we get asked all the time, you know, what makes you guys so different? Because just as you said, Nicole, when you came to Solutions, you know, people got their head up, they're looking at you in the eyes, they're smiling, they're light, you know, they're engaging. I mean, you go to a lot of these nonprofit homeless places now, and there's a lot of, as I say, just a lot of desperation. You see a lot of things out there that are not everywhere, not all the time, but there is much more of this heaviness and this darkness. So the three uniques. So the first thing is that, you know, we're root strikers. So for every 1,000 hacking at the branches of homelessness, one strikes at the root, and we don't hack branches. So we have this knack after all these decades of doing this. We seek out and we close in, and then we, this is a little bit of the Marine in me still, but, and then we strategically strike at the root. And when we do that, we end this homelessness thing for those that we serve permanently. So that's the first unique. The second one is, you know, we're freedom-loving dependency crushers, you know. If you haven't figured it out yet, I love painting pictures with words, and I'm the chief storyteller at Solutions, and I am the cultural architect. So we don't manage programs or projects or people that enable or promote the low bar of dependency to operate within our field of view. So if we see it, you know, we just all have this knack of just being able to understand it. We get it out. Like if, and it comes from this thing. I was asked to consider this by a mentor a long time ago. He said, Chris, you know, he said, you know, never do for another human being that which they can and should and must do for themselves.
Amen.
And the other thing was, is you can only take a person as far as you've taken yourself. And this thing that is, you know, freedom from dependency is a real cool, neat thing. I mean, ask any of the thousands of people who have achieved that at Solutions for Change, and they'll tell you why. You know, why it's a neat thing. It's freedom not only from the welfare system but it's freedom from drugs. It's freedom from bad toxic relationships. It's freedom from the things that keep people stuck in the churn. But it really is freedom from dependency. And so we're freedom loving dependency crushers, and that's our unique number two. And the third unique is, I think, the most powerful of all of our uniques. It's the transformed, now transformed. So 3 decades. I mean, that's how long it took us to master making our secret weapon. So we make overcomers who then make more, who then make more. So, yeah, I mean, we use the word made because it takes real work and commitment to become an overcomer. And, you know, the last thing I'll say about the three uniques is there's a lot of folks out there who know now, especially with all the tools of social media and other things today, they know how to manage your impression. They're really good at it. And so they might be able to say and try to use some optics around the root strike. Maybe they are root strikers. They might, you know, be good at even, you know, making that impression with you, or perhaps that, you know, they don't enable dependency. But the one thing, and I say this because a lot of stuff that Solutions has done over the years, you know, others come in, they see it, they like it, they take it. And I actually like, yes, take my stuff, man. I mean, like, I want you to take my stuff, like, please use it, you know, but please use it, you know, in a way that's real and not fake. But the one thing that they can't fake is growing an army of overcomers. And I got to tell you how excited we are today at Solutions for Change, because today, after, you know, being at this thing for 3 decades, 20, you know, a little bit over 2 decades at Solutions, we have amassed a significant cadre of people who were once the very least of us, they were seen by many in society, even themselves, as they were not worth it, that they didn't have really anything to give to themselves and to their kids and their family and to each other and to society. And they are on fire today. They are, we have seen them being lifted up, and they are committed to do this. And this is really exciting because it's taken us a long time to get there. They're committed to serving for the sake of others while also working to transform, to fundamentally change how society sees and acts on serving the most vulnerable amongst us. So, you know, we say to go from the least of us to showing up as the very best of us. And I tell people when they hear this, they say, you know, I can just see it in their eyes, like it's impossible. Well, impossible, you say? Come see it for yourself. Come meet the overcomers. And it's not just three or four or five of them. You know, I put whole, like mass filled, a room filled of them, bringing politicians down, close the door because I don't have to be in there. And you go ahead and listen to them because they are going to share with you what the reality is of what's really going on up there. And then just, you know, I always like to just end it with this, and I say, you know, what if the answer to homelessness was right in front of us this entire time? What if the homeless themselves, with the right interventions and supports, are the answer?
Yeah.
I mean, it really, that's what we believe.
Yeah. Well, as I said, when I was there, I got a chance to meet several people that were walking around, and one of the, so I met with Rob, and then there was also one of the ladies that was there that's part of the program, and she shared with me, she actually brought me over to her unit, and she was showing me pictures of her kids, and she, and what really struck me was her excitement and her gratitude for the process and what she was, you know, where she came from and where she was in the moment, and then where she knew she was going and had the confidence to go because she knew that she was supported in the process. It was awesome. So talk about the areas of wellness that you focus on and maybe a little bit about that Solutions Academy, and because there's a certain time frame, they come in, and you know, there's a point of graduation, and kind of a little bit about what that looks like.
Yeah, so you know, we learned early on that, you know, the strategies and the methodologies of the homelessness response system didn't work well for our people. So I, you know, first thing I ask people to do is throw everything out that you've heard about how homelessness is addressed. Shelters, no, throw that out. And people need shelter, of course they do, but we don't do shelters, and we don't do, you know, a lot of these entitlement type of programs. We see people, you know, as if people are worth it, and we, you know, we reject the whole notion that they're worth less. And honestly, what you see is what you do is what you get. And so the one thing we figured out early on is what if we could create an academy? What if we addressed homelessness just like, you know, you would if you, you know, you grow up, you graduate high school, well, you go on and you go to college, you know? Our people, interestingly enough, of the folks that we serve, many of them, and I know it might sound kind of strange, but many of them, they have not learned how to be a parent. They weren't parented themselves. They haven't learned a lot of things like how to manage money or, you know, what is work ethic? What does that look like? What does work ethic really look like? What is it even, you know? How do you provide value? How do you find your gifts? You know, how do you do that? And how then do you use your gifts? So all these things, right? So, and the thing that we realized when we started this academy is just like a college, you have a core curriculum. Well, we decided that our core curriculum was going to be servant leadership. And I got to tell you, when I first introduced it, my peers would say, "What are you doing, man? It's like these people have nothing. You know, they're homeless. Like, why are you asking them to consider being servant leaders?" And I knew I was onto something back then. I didn't really know exactly what, but I just kept listening to that constant tug, i.e., the Holy Spirit, and just kept, keep getting up and trying this and trying that. And what we learned is that if we could build a curriculum with the core of it being servant leadership, we had 13 behaviors that we introduced. And these 13 behaviors, these 13 servant leadership behaviors are at the very core of what we do throughout our academy. So they go through, hundreds of hours of this stuff over the 2 years. Now we say, I like to use specific kind of time frames. So it's a 700-day academy, just short of 2 years. And they come in and they go, we had to build our own metric system, because the system out there, the homelessness industrial complex, or the HIC as we call it, they were only concerned about one thing. Can you get this human being behind the door and somehow keep them there? It's like, well, what if they're behind the door and they're using drugs? Well, they're behind the door, Chris. It's done. Their homelessness has been ended. Well, it's been ended. They're not physically homeless, but my goodness, if they're using drugs, if they're abusing their kids, if they're doing a lot of other, things that are unhealthy for them and their children and society, how is that a success, And so, but that was how that was the entire metric is, can you get them behind the door and will they stay there? So solution said, what are the areas that we need to really intentionally focus on? And there's like seven areas of wellness. So we're looking at things like behavioral health, physical health, nutritional health, spiritual health, vocational health. And so we've built a whole curriculum with classes, intentional classes that address each one of those. And what's kind of neat about Solutions for Change is that we knew here that we had something with the servant leadership model in court and, baked in. And we knew that we were on the hunt for the root causes and we were getting there for many people. And so if I hold up this phone used to just be a phone, like, phones were phones. You'd use it to call somebody. Well, today there are mini computers and they have this thing called an operating system in it. And so what we feel we've done here is we believe that we have trailblazed, and it's been because we've been disruptors. And I used to like say that with a badge, like we're social sector disruptors. But frankly, Nicole, I'm getting tired of that. I want to be a market leader. I want to help and serve and be a market leader versus this market disruptor thing. It's been a lot of years, and that's where we're going now. But you look at the operating system, and so we really believe that we have created a new way, a new operating system, a new OS. And so what we would do is like we would take these classes or these workshops or these experiential engagements, and we'd see them kind of like an app. We put it on our operating system. Hey, do we like it? Oh yeah, Chris, it's great. This person that now sometimes I say this and people are like, what are you talking about? Like apps that solve home? I was like, no, it's an analogy. But we would take it, and everybody loves these things today, and you can download an app, and so we would put an app on. It would be, let's say, a parenting class, or let's say a workforce development class or a workforce development day. I mean, maybe we take a bunch of our folks out and we do a whole big work project, but with intention, and we're talking about, hey, here's what it looks like to be part of a team of people that you're a team member here. Here's what that looks like, and we do all this different stuff. And if we like it, we keep the app. If we don't like it, we just like delete. Now it sounds a little hard maybe, but the bottom line is I'm looking for the best stuff. And there's people like you out there and others that have committed themselves in service they have, you know, amazing ideas that they have, you know, built and created curriculum or created, you know, a program or something. Well, I want that. I want to try that, right? And so it's, I'll put that on our OS. And I'm like, hey, that fits really well. That's great. And you know what? It also is aligned with our culture of emotional intelligence and servant leadership. So we're going to keep that one. Now think about almost 24 years of trying different things around these seven areas of health and learning and failing and making mistakes and saying, oh gosh, that was, you know, kind of dumb, but just never giving up, because realizing that these are human beings and that, you know, there is no one size fits all, as I believe, you know, our government feels like it can just be a one size top down, you know, fits all kind of thing. And so we've been relentlessly seeking what really works for the human beings, the souls that we serve. And, you know, I don't want to say, you know, it's, you know, we're perfect, but man, I tell you what, Nicole, we have something, man. And it's powerful, because I know it's powerful, because when people like you come in, they just like, and the deeper they get with us, they're like, there's nothing else out there like this. You know, this is amazing, right? And it's because our people are, it, it, like you use the word empowered, absolutely equipped, inspired, you know, and they, I tell them, I see you as a gem. And they're looking at me like, dude, you just met me. You know, I've only been here 3 days, and I got this guy called the CEO sitting down, welcoming me in. And I've done that now with every single soul for 30 years. And I look right at them, and I let them know undeniably that they are a gem, and that inside them there is this, they are the gem, it is in them. And so we're going to go on a little excursion, and we're going to find that thing, and then we're going to dust it off, we're going to buff it up, and we're going to let it rip, you know, because it will shine, you know. And everybody, you know, they hear that and they don't quite understand it, but you know, it's just talk unless you have the culture and the framework to bring it all out, and the people. I mean, I can't tell you how blessed I am to have the kind of people that I have around me. It's, you know, it's pretty amazing. So that was kind of a long answer to your question, but that was it. I'm glad you asked it, because it really, it is, this academy is so different than anything else that we've seen, that many of our constituents, our donors, our volunteers have seen. And we believe that it has a, you know, real potential to be shared.
Well, a few months ago, I was talking to a gentleman in Irvine, and he has a heart for the homelessness issue that's happening up there. But I mean, LA is just crazy, of course, down here and so forth. And so we were talking about it, and he's an architect. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, he's thinking about buildings and innovative ways of helping people to get shelter. And as we were talking exactly what you were saying. My mind's going, yeah, okay, well, that's good, but what is that going to do? You know, and so you work backwards. And so as I was driving home, I was talking to my husband on the phone, and I was telling him about the conversation, and I was unpacking. I was going, yeah, but you need to do this. And he's like, yeah, we need this and that. And we were kind of working our way backwards as to what it would have to look like in order to solve it. And then, as I said, I show up at your place, and I'm like, yeah, that's what needs to happen. It's awesome. And it's better than than we even were thinking about it. But of course, being in the space of transformation, you know, that there's a certain process. And so I absolutely, I love it. Your motto, what's your motto again?
Well, we've been using this forever. It's get up, suit up, and show up.
Yeah. Yeah. And the woman that was walking around with me and explaining all the programs, she was really proud about that and saying, you know, she said, even when she's in her unit and they share a kitchen, deliberately share a kitchen, yeah, with with the person that's living next to them. And she said, you know, so I can't hide out of my house, you know, or my, in my apartment. And, you know, there's always somebody there checking in with people and, you know, make sure that everybody's good. And it's a family, it's a really great family community. Even as I was walking around, people were saying hello and she was saying hello to people, and it was awesome. So
yeah,
you mentioned about scaling in this model. You know, you've got, I believe it was 7 properties right now, in North County, San Diego, in and around here. And, yeah, what a great model to be able to scale, across the country. I'm sure it's, you know, it's a concept that is not limited to even the US market. It's, you know, internationally it could be used. And so it would be really great to see that happen. And, yeah. So,
yeah, I mean, we hope, that's our plan. I mean, there's been a lot of obstacles, as you can imagine, but we have some very motivated folks helping us. So leave that, you know, and it's not going to be a franchise scale model. It'll be a licensing and consulting model. So we think that there's a lot of other places around the country that if they could see in its entirety, the power of this thing and how it's and how the transformed now are transforming, the overcomers themselves are so involved in this, and that they would be interested in it. And so if we can earn that trust, right, earn that kind of respect, which we, you know, we feel we can, then we will engage with them, show them how it's done, license our stuff, license our academy, license our software, which we've created, which I said, like, it's not just measuring, you know, behind the door, it's measuring what we call from bottom left to top right, meaning bottom left is total dependency and negative well-being. Top right is no longer dependent, thriving, working, living in the community, and being healthy. So, you know, we can show that, then we feel like we have a real responsibility and obviously an opportunity, but a responsibility to share that with others. And that's what our plan is. And we feel like it's a very workable plan. I mean, we're excited about it.
Yeah. So how do you fund this?
Yeah. So for many years, we kind of stumbled into this big solution. It was probably about, I'd say, 15 years ago. And yeah, it was the 2008 crash, the Great Recession. And like, wow, we're getting all these people through, you know, our academy. They're stuck at the back door. We've got to get more housing. And so with the Great Recession, there was a tremendous amount of foreclosures and a lot of real estate that tanked. So Solutions had the opportunity here to work with our local, state, and federal government. And so we got very good at developing drug-free empowerment housing. We call it transformational housing today. And we just learned it. We didn't know, we'd never done it before, but we learned it. My wife and I learned it. We got good at it. And we went on a massive tear. We started, you know, building these apartments, you know, around North County. And so we built 5 of them, you know. And what then happened is that I could make a guarantee to someone to say, if you finish this program, you will get housing. And that was a big thing, right? So the answer to your question is, well, we had this amazing investor called the taxpayer, and I personally have feel so deeply that I have a fiduciary, a moral, ethical obligation to the taxpayer. The relationship is with them, not with the government go-between public agency. And so they loved how Solutions were just, you know, we could do this. So we would get tens of millions of dollars to build these places. And then we would take care of all of the program operations through the private sector. And we did that through relationships with big business and a lot of churches, right? So the churches were involved, a lot of individuals. I mean, people love this model. It's like, let the government help build the bricks and sticks, but then don't tell us how to solve it, right? Like, I mean, thank you very much, you know, government, but, you know, don't tell me how to serve a person in need. We've got that figured out. We know how. It's people helping people. And so that was the model, and we would raise you know, a significant amount of funding through that model. And we would, you know, we got kind of fortunate. God brought us some big philanthropists in 2012 and 13. We had huge 800 people attended galas with world speakers there. We had a first lady, a former secretary of state. And this is all got from these local folks who were on fire about solutions. And they would come in and speak about and say, you know, I was like, wow, I'm looking at a former first lady and she's saying how amazing Solutions for Change is in front of 800, you know, North County, you know, leaders. And so there you go. So we were able to, you know, have a really significant, I think, commitment from the private sector and then the government. And then in 2016, that all changed when Tammy walks in my office and hands me a letter from the state that says, you will now convert all of your programs, everything that you just built, you will now convert it to drug allowed housing. And that model is called Housing First. And I want people to know, and I think I'm really encouraged because I think our public now is finally becoming aware. They've casted Housing First as the new approach to end homelessness. It's not, clearly not working. I mean, everybody can see that. California is in a really bad shape with this problem. And it's because the model is a dependency promoting model that literally takes any kind of accountability between human beings out of the equation and just says, hey, you need housing. Here's a place to live. And now they're spending $800,000 to build one unit of housing for one homeless person. And there's no connection, man. There's just like, you know, they're behind a door. And that's the sad thing, man, especially as a veteran. I'm watching them do this to our veterans and they're dying in record numbers and people die behind those doors. And so when I sat down with, you know, this a U.S. senator's staff, and I called the drug housing. He said, "Chris, you can't do that anymore. It's drug housing, man." You know, I mean, it is, right? And so I am again a disruptor, and I wasn't very well liked back then. But we rejected that mandate, and in order for us to survive it, we had to give up all of our government funding that helped us build these places. And we had local government funding that was not much. It was about 15%. But it was still $600,000 a year. It's a lot of, you know, funds from our local folks. We had to give all that up in order to stay true to our core values. So it has not been easy for us, but it's been necessary. We must do it. We are not going to chase the money. We are not going to sell out that promise that I personally made, that we all make, that started with that 9-year-old girl when she said, you know, when she pulled on my sleeve that night, and I looked over and I knew that the only way to get that 9-year-old girl out of that shelter was through the mother. And that promise, you know, it can only happen in all of our opinions, with a place where you don't allow rampant drug use. You know, I mean, how can you solve something so tough to solve when people are, you know, actively using methamphetamine and heroin, and now with fentanyl, it's incredible. So we stuck to our core values. They then did take all of our money. They didn't give us all the renewal money, and. You know, I'm sorry that I have to share this on your show. It's just become public. I'm signing a transfer of those places that we built to another nonprofit, because after years of trying to fight Rome, Rome wins. And it is just the way it is. And I have to be grateful for, this opportunity. I think the money that came to us to help us build this, I'm not happy about having to give up these sacred beachheads that we won, but we're transferring these housing developments now to another nonprofit, because I will not, we will not, none of us will run drug housing. And it's so bad. I mean, we don't have the teeth that, we don't have, it's not just the teeth, we don't have the ability to create the relationships and create the culture and the community, which is so important at these places, because the government has said, you can't do any of that stuff. You can't require jobs. You cannot require that they don't use drugs. And so we're stuck. And so now we have to do this, with all of it, with the private sector, and that's our future, Nicole. We're excited. You're going to hear about this. I'll share this with you soon, but there's a large church in North County that offered us land at no cost to go and build housing, build, our kind of housing. And that has been approved by our boards, by their board and our board. And we're excited about it, because we think there's a lot of other churches out there with a lot more land that they too want relationship. They too want transformation. They too want to see discipleship as the way forward, and not just containing precious souls behind doors and hearing about people passing away alone, separated from our community and separated from Christ, and so we're excited about that. We think that that's our way forward, and but it has been a rocky road, that's for sure.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's so crazy when you think about it, because it sounds compassionate to say, hey, let's put people, behind a door, and we don't, but then it's really about, we don't have to look at that. We don't have to see it. And it's just, it's out of sight, out of mind, if you will. And,
yes.
Yeah. It's what you're doing is actually true compassion, is actually, sometimes it might be tough love, but it's, I get that it's not about, rejecting people. It's about actually saying we need to have an environment where we can help people to thrive. Yeah. Especially when you're having families and they're walking around with the kids and so forth. I mean, you don't want this systemic thing. That's how you, otherwise the churn just continues, that, because they see that's what it is. Wow. Well, I am, as I said, I'm excited about what you're doing. And I know that even our church, the Station Church, we have been supporting you. I know that it's come up in conversation a lot, Solutions for Change, which is part of the reason why I ended up there, was because it was a bunch of people that were talking about it and wanting to support it. And so I'm excited about where it's going. And I know that when one door closes, another door opens, and it's usually got to open up a much bigger door, and you'll be able to do it the way you want to do it, and be able to truly help people. So that is awesome. And look forward to seeing how that develops, and also being part of supporting that and however we can. So thanks, Chris. I appreciate that. And I'm going to encourage our listeners and our viewers now to go and check out a little bit more about what you're doing. Solutionsforchange.org is the website. And, maybe it's like donating to, to the cause, or getting involved, or maybe you know somebody that has a heart for this, this situation and wants to get involved. Maybe you know somebody who has some finances. Maybe you know somebody who has a family foundation, then share this with them. I encourage you to do that and learn more about this model. And if we can get this model, the model's already built. Model works. Now it's about supporting them to continue, and also being able to scale it and put in a whole lot of other places, so we can help a lot of people to get out of the dependency and be empowered and be who God created them to be. So I always say leaders of transformation take action. Take action on something that you learned today. And I hope this inspired you. And we'd love to hear your stories. If you are, wanting to get involved or whatever, you can, of course, reach out directly to solutionsforchange.org, to their website, to Chris and his team. Or you can, of course, reach out to us. You can go to leadersoftransformation.com, and we want to be part of the solution, not the problem. So again, thanks, Chris, for being here. We look forward to continuing the conversation, and thank you to our listeners for being here. And we look forward to seeing you next week on another episode of the Leaders of Transformation.